let go of all that binds you, of all that burdens you, of what you carry, of all that shames you, of fear, of trespass, of transgressions, of woundedness. Let go of guilt. Let go of anger. Let go of small-mindedness and pettiness, of ways of being that no longer work for you, of compulsions that consume your living. Let go of what you cannot change. Let go of regret, of that which haunts you. Let go of pain. Let go of ways in which you missed the mark. Let go. Please join us in our chalice lighting. Together, let us say,
we come together
mutual desire, God, yet we are drawn together by a belief that how we are in the world, who we are together, matters. We light this chalice together, knowledge that love, not fear, can change this world. Please join us in our opening hymn, number 1000, in the teal hymnal and on the screen.
We'll sing verses 1, 2, 3, and then 1 again.
Please rise if you are willing and able.
Please remain standing and join us in our litany together. We begin. Wake my soul. It takes energy to stand and defiantly stand against voices that wear me down. Wake, oh my soul. It takes the force of my will to take charge of my life and do what I can. Wake up, O my soul. It takes a choice on my part to act or be still, to learn to receive as well as to give. Wake up, O my soul. Through the movement of my soul and my heart, I can change my mind. Wake up, O my soul. When I recognize what is good in others, I magnify the force of good. Wake up, O my soul. Please be seated. And now we invite our children forward as Ken shares with us our message for all ages today.
Thank you very much. I'm glad you were the first one down. Here, we have a book today, so why don't you all come over here? Yep. So they're going to be talking about change. And I thought I had things planned out, and guess what? We had to change it. That's just how it goes, right? We don't complain, we don't fuss. Sometimes we just got to go through and we got to change things.
So,
I found this great book that's entitled When This World Was New. Now, just judging by this cover, what do you think the book's going to be about? Snow, okay, fair. World, okay, that's fair. Anybody else? Yes. New, okay, yep, it's in the title, all right. The boy, it could be about the boy. So, we're going to read this story, and I will share the pictures. It says, it was our first day in this country. My parents and I had came in the night before from an island on an ocean that was warm and far away. That doesn't look warm. He must have come from somewhere really far away then, right? They had to take two planes. The first plane flew low over clear waters. I looked out the window at the boats beneath us. I saw large stingrays swimming near the surface of the sea. Papa looked out the window with me. He seemed worried. Mama was very quiet. We landed our small plane near a beach, but we didn't stay there. We moved to another plane. This was a jet. We flew high over the clouds and into the night. It was exciting, but I was also scared. We'll talk about some of this stuff later. Although, yeah, there's really no way. After a few hours in the air, we landed at a big airport. There were hundreds of people running from one end of the terminal to the other. They were carrying suitcases, packages, and boxes. They didn't smile, and they did not speak Spanish. I took Mama's hand and held it tightly. So, let's just chat for just a second. So this little boy is coming from someplace warm. He had to take two planes, and he was scared of flying, and now he's someplace where people don't speak Spanish. How do we think this boy's feeling? Scared. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. Overwhelmed, yeah. Maybe he does. You're right. Let's keep reading and see what happens here. At the gate, Uncle Berto was waiting. He saw me and he cried out my name. He ran to greet us. He was happy. He was in this country alone. He was glad to have relatives around him once again. Uncle Berto led us to his car. He drove along the highway that was as long as a comet's tail. Cars sped past us as fast as meteors. The light shining through the windows of the tall buildings reminded me of the stars in the Caribbean nights. Uncle Berto was talking about America. He liked it here, but he said that winters were long and cold and that you could fall on ice and hurt yourself. He said that you had to speak English, but it was not an easy language to learn. And that, you know, Los Americanos were kind, but there were few here who were not friendly towards foreigners. I was a foreigner, and I didn't speak English, and I didn't know how to walk on ice, and I was scared. Papa had worries, too. He wanted to take Mama to a doctor. She had not been feeling well, and she looked sad lately, and she worried a lot. And he told Uncle Berto that in order to help Mama, he needed money. To make money, he needed a job. But how could he find a job in a new country? How could he buy Mama medicine? How could he buy food for us and clothes and rent an apartment? Mama nodded as Papa asked those questions. Uncle Berto nodded as well. He told Papa that everything would be fine and that it was just a matter of time. So it sounds like everybody has these worries, right? They're going through a complete upheaval and they've got worries and they're scared. They're together though, right? It sounds like they're talking it through. Let's keep going and see how this ends up. Uncle Berto left the highway to cross a bridge. He drove down a ramp and up a hill and down the road and went through a park. Then he slowed down a bit and stopped in front of a house. It was a small house built of wood. It stood next to a clearing on the side of a small hill. We went inside. There was a living room and a kitchen and two bedrooms, and the rooms had furniture. Well, that's a good sign. Uncle Berto pointed to lots of cans of food on the kitchen table. Food for a week. He pointed to a pile of winter clothes on a bed in one of the rooms. He said, winter clothes. He gave Papa the key. So it seems like Uncle Berto's been here a while, right? Yeah. So like these people are, this family, this boy, he's coming into a house where it looks like he is going to be taken care of. Right? He sees the food and he sees the winter clothes and he may still feel a little scared, but there's something there to kind of give him security, right? Yeah, okay. Yeah, thank you. The next morning, Papa came into my room. Wake up, he whispered. He wanted me to get up. It was still dark. The shade on the window was down and I sat on the edge of the bed. Papa had on clothes he had never worn before. Boots, heavy pants, coat, a scarf? He helped me into a pair of boots. He gave me a coat, but my arms couldn't find the sleeves. I was not used to winter clothing. I was still scared. Everything was happening so fast. On my first day here, I had to go to a new school where no one knew Spanish. How could I tell the teacher that I had to go to the bathroom? How could I learn my lessons? Boy, these are some real fears, right? Yeah. This is a big amount of change for this little boy, isn't it? Yeah. Would you think you would feel scared if this happened to you too? Yeah. Oh my gosh. It could be really scary. But luckily he still has his parents and his family there. I told Papa that I should not go to school. I thought Uncle Berto should teach me some English first. But Papa said that I was a good student and that I would do well in any language. Then he told me there was something he wanted me to see. He took me to the living room. There, I saw a magic I had never seen before. I ran to the window. Outside, there were millions of white rose petals floating downward. Well, what would you call it if you'd never seen snow before? I mean, that seems pretty apt, right? That's it. Maybe. You never know. Snow, Papa said. Buttoning his coat, he opened the door. I followed him out. The front steps on the sidewalk and the street were all gone, vanished under the powder that was as white as fine sugar. The parked cars had become polar bears. There was no sound at all. All was still but for the falling snow. Papa stepped onto the sidewalk. I thought he might slip, but he didn't. I stepped down and my feet sank softly into the snow. I tilted my head back. Flakes touched my face, melting on my cheeks. Papa cupped his hands and shaped the snow into a ball. He pitched it at the street sign. He missed, but he didn't try again. He wasn't wearing gloves, and his hands were getting cold. He turned down to the field by the house. In the silence of the snow, he trudged over. Mm-hmm. The field rose gently. The snow falling on the clearing was so white and pure, it seemed as if a slice of cloud had floated down to the earth. Papa began to walk towards the top of the hill, and I walked beside him. He was breathing hard, steam puffs from his mouth. and nose. His nose was red and shiny. His face was wet as if it had bathed by a spray from a wave. It felt like we were walking on sand, on a sand dune, but it was much, much colder. The climb tired us. Our toes were icy and ticklish. Up to now, we had neither looked back nor down. We turned around and looked at the field. On the white, clear snow, we saw our footprints. The initial tracks were clumsy, crooked, leaning to one side, but the rest were deep and firm, one set of prints larger than the other. Papa studied his footprints. "That's something I've always wanted to do," he said. He placed his arm around me, and we stood together, my body leaning against his. We didn't move as if we were frozen. The gentle patches we had made stretched out before us, a large signature on the expanse of a wide scroll. The sound of a car horn came from behind the house. It was Uncle Berto in his car. Neighbors began to come out, shovels scraped the sidewalks, engines were turning on. "We have to go," Uncle Berto called. Papa and I went back to the house to say goodbye to Mama. She was surprised. She surprised us. She was not sleeping, but was standing by the window. She was smiling. It was the first time she had smiled in a long while. She embraced Papa, and then she kissed me. Papa and I climbed into Uncle Berto's car. He said he'd take me to school first, and then afterwards he'd take Papa to the factory that needed workers. As Uncle Berto drove past the field, I looked at our footprints in the snow. Papa, sitting in the front, was also looking at the prints. He turned to me. He smiled, and I smiled back. I was still scared, but not as much. And then he went ice skating. So that was a lot of change that this boy went through, right? And he was scared, which is normal. It was about the boy, you're right. And he was scared. He was scared, but he kind of went along. He had his family there to help him out. And he realized that sometimes change can be scary, but change is not always a bad thing, right? Right. And he did not know that it was snowing. He called it little white rose petals, didn't he? Yeah, that was pretty neat. All right, let's go downstairs and we'll talk about a few more things then, okay?
Go now in peace, may the spirit of love surround you everywhere you may go. Go now in peace, go now in peace, may the spirit of love surround you everywhere you
Our reading today is taken from the writings of the late Forrest Church, a very well-known and well-published Unitarian Universalist minister. This is from his essay, "To Begin Changing Your Life, Thoughts for a Summer Day." Let me share with you 10 simple hints on beginning, on how to reboot your spiritual life if it has become automatic or stale. Getting your soul in shape may lead to an awe-inspiring mystical encounter someday. Yet how to begin, or begin anew, isn't the least bit mystifying. Here are 10 simple thoughts to launch you on your way. 1. Begin here. How deeply you would long for all the things you take for granted if suddenly you lost them. So much of what we want, we already have. So want what you have. Begin here. 2. Begin now. You have everything you need, everything plus the bonus of today, one day more than you will have if you wait until tomorrow. Begin now. 3. Begin as you are. At your fingertips is a treasure trove of memories and dreams. Put one memory together with one good dream and you are ready to begin. Good memories are memories that make you feel good about yourself. Good dreams are the stuff of which tomorrow's good memories are made. Begin as you are. 4. Begin by doing what you can. No more, but also no less. Don't throw yourself against the wall. Walk around it. You can't do the impossible, but so much is possible. So many of the things you haven't tried are you still can do. To get around the wall, you can set out in either direction. The wall has two ends. The important thing is to start walking. Begin by doing what you can. 5. Begin with those you are closest to. They can cheer you on only if you let them. Invite them to give you a hand, bow, and to lend you a hand, ask, and to take your hand. No one can take your hand if you bury it in your pocket. You say they won't cheer you on, help you out, or take your hand. Maybe not, but how will you know without asking? Begin by asking. 6. Begin by turning the page. Today you can open a new chapter of your life. If you are trapped in your story, stuck in place, botching the same old lines, revise the script. Place a new line or two. Practice a new line or two. When reading a book, or sometimes reach the bottom of a page, only to realize we've been glossing its words without registering its meaning. We haven't been paying attention. We don't have the faintest idea what we've just read. So go back to the top of the page and try to concentrate. It happens again. Sentences dissolve into words, words into sounds. The books of our lives are no different. Resist the temptation to wallow over some dark passage until you know exactly what's wrong. You never will. Besides, perfection is not life's goal. Neither is unnecessary pain. If you are stuck, open a new chapter. Turn the page. 7. By cleaning up your slate. Don't erase the past. File it by experience to keep it handy should you need it. But don't obsess over it. Ticking off a growing list of grievances gets you nothing from life's store. As for the things on your to-do list that you'll probably never do, place them under a statute of limitations. When they serve no longer to inspire but only to haunt you, X them off. Not only is there no reason to carry over unnecessary indictments from one day to the next, but you'll also never reform the things you can about yourself until you stop trying to reform the things you can't. Begin by cleaning up your slate. 8. By looking for new questions, not old answers. Answers close doors. Questions open them. Answers lock us in place. Questions lead us on adventures. Socrates boasted himself the most ignorant man in Athens. Each new insight raised a dozen questions, extending the compass of his ignorance. Yet beyond every ridge he climbed, there lay a wider vista. The more questions we have, the farther we can see. 9. Begin with little regard for where your path may lead. Destinations are overrated and never what we imagine. Even should we somehow manage to get where we are heading, we won't end up there. Until life ends, no destination is final. In fact, the best destinations are those we look back upon as new beginnings. Good journeys always continue. So don't be driven by desire, that empty place within you. Never to rest until you reach your goal. Invest your joy in the journey. And 10. Begin in the middle. Our lives will end mid-story, so why not begin there? Don't wait around for the perfect starting pistol, or until you are ready. You may never be ready. No reason to wait in the grandstand for some official to guide you to the gate. Jump the fence. Enter the race in the middle, here, now, as you are, by doing what you can with those who are closest to you, by turning the page, cleaning your slate, looking for new questions, not old answers, and with little regard for where your path will lead. Finally, before you begin, a bonus suggestion. Begin small. Dream possible dreams. Set out to climb a single hill, not every mountain. Soul work needn't be strenuous to be high impact. You can begin transforming your life with a single phone call, or by writing a kind letter, or by opening your blinds to let the sun flood in. Don't say it's nothing. It's everything, for you have now begun. At this time, we take the opportunity to fulfill this congregation's weekly commitment to assist as we are able to the greater community outside our doors. As we live out our values in this world, we ask all who join with us today to align your financial commitments with your values. We are sharing a plate this month with, who is we are sharing it with? Please be as generous as you can. And to donate online, you can go to our website at uucqc.org. And at the bottom of the page, there's a donate button that will allow you to donate via PayPal with a credit card. While the offering is being taken, we invite you to come forward and light a candle for any joys or sorrows written upon your heart. If there are any written in the Joys and Sorrows book, we will share those and those that may be available online. They will be read after the offertory. The offering will now be taken. Thank you. Thank you. As we gather today, we are aware of the hidden joys and sorrows in all of our hearts. In time of sharing, we take a moment. We will read from our Joys and Sorrows book for those personal life events which we have chosen to share. Is there anything online that would be shared? Thank you. Hannah Harrington has shared with us today. She goes, thank you to all who helped lead hymns, perform special music, and help with other musical tasks in our recent transition. We are excited to welcome Gates Thomas. We have a pastoral care team. If you need any kind of assistance of a spiritual or personal nature, please feel free to reach out to the team members or myself, who may be able to walk with you as you navigate life's challenges. Let us become aware of the energy that brings us together in beloved community. As we share a time of silent meditation, may we open our minds and hearts to a place of quiet, to a silent prayer for the healing of pain and the balm of love. Spirit of all blessing, be with us in the ordinariness of our days. May hope's light guard us and keep cynicism from our hearts. May the energy of laughter build endurance for the dark times of our lives. May creativity's vision grant the possibility of seeing old relationships with new eyes. May the oil of healing keep us from anger's hardness or despair. May the mantle of humility give courage to admit when we are wrong. May compassion's loom weave in us the discipline to forgive. May patience help us bear in mind that ours is not the only scale of time. May the flame of justice be a beacon for the choices we must make. May peace be ever in us and sustain our stressful days. Spirit of all blessing, be with us in the ordinariness of our days. Amen, and blessed be. Please join us in our hymn of meditation, number 15, The Lone Wild Bird, and rise as you're willing and able in body or spirit.
Thank you.
Please be seated. I can't tell you how happy I am you're here. I just can't. As the classic comic strip character Pogo is so often quoted, we have met the enemy and he is us. We are most often stymied in social and personal transformation by our own fear and discomfort with change. For me, growth is a primary purpose in our lives. I know this with every fiber of my being, and I have known it in some form most of my life. I chose and accepted the call to ministry in great part because, for me, I can think of no other path or calling which offers me, and in fact forces me, to engage so constantly and profoundly in the act of being not more than I am, but of being the fullest possible me that I can. An acorn does not become something else besides an oak tree, but it moves all the time towards being more fully an oak tree all the time. Growth is a form of change, and change often means discomfort as things go from being what they were to what they are becoming. These chances to grow and become are not always welcome. Notice we've moved the piano. I have been using the term moving your cheese. With some people know what that is. It comes from a book from the 1990s on corporate culture and change, and about how small transitions, small changes, small movements of things can often create very large emotional responses in systems. We have been struggling and talking about how we might be doing joys and concerns and collection separately because they have separate theological frames and different tones and moods. So we might be experimenting with that in our orders of service going forward, like we did last week. So expect change. Expect to have your cheese moved, folks. That is a part of the process we are all engaged in here. Now, a friend and colleague of mine many years ago once coined the acronym AFGO, or A-F-G-O, for another freaking growth opportunity. You can use whatever language in there you might choose personally. His common response to these unwanted intrusions in our stable, though thoroughly unfulfilled lives. So if this is so painful, why do I do it? I do this because I endure the incidental discomfort of change because I have faith that what is beyond the pain that I sometimes experience in growing is more than worth the effort, that the possibility beyond it may actually lead to joy and fulfillment. I do not choose to change because I don't like myself, well, most of the time, or my life, most of the time, but because at my core, I probably love myself most of the time and want to be even more of me, of who I am. Now, some people would say more of you could be very terrifying. Why are you doing that? And I have family members who would agree. Just as you want to change things about yourself and your life, because at your core, you are loved and loving and want your life to be better in reflecting that reality. In our modern world, we often think that personal development is something new, that the self-help culture is a modern creation. However, this is not the case. This is not a new desire for us as human beings. In Boston, in September of 1838, the great Unitarian thinker, the Reverend Dr. William Ellery Channing, delivered a lecture on self-culture as the opening address in a series of public lectures to and for working people, as Channing put it, to those who are occupied by manual labor. Pardoning the non-gender inclusive language, listen to what he had to say. He says, there are two powers of the human soul which make self-culture possible, the self-searching and the self-forming power. We have the power not only of tracing our powers, but of guiding and impelling them, not only of seeing our faculties grow, but of applying to them means and influences to aid their growth. Of all the discoveries of which men need to make, the most important is that of the self-forming power treasured up in themselves. It transcends in importance all our power over outward nature. There is more of divinity in that, in the force which impels the outward universe. This makes self-culture possible and binds it on us as a solemn duty. To cultivate anything, be it plant, an animal, a mind, is to make grow. Growth, expansion, is the end. Nothing admits culture but that which has a principle of life capable of being expanded. He who does what he can to unfold all his powers and capacities, especially his noble ones, so as to become a well-proportioned, vigorous, excellent, happy being, practices self-culture. He goes on, cherish a true respect for yourselves. Feel that your nature is worth more than everything which is foreign to you. He who has not caught a glimpse of his own rational and spiritual being, of something within him superior to the world and allied to divinity, wants the true spring of that purpose of self-culture on which I have insisted as the first of all the means of improvement. Similarly, in more contemporary language, the work of family systems psychologist Murray Bowen offers us some insights into how we can actually achieve change in our lives. Primarily, we must first recognize we are not solitary creatures floating out here on our own. We exist in a myriad network of relationships, both past and present, which influence how we behave and what choices we make unconsciously and consciously. Dr. Bowen writes the following. He says, systems thinking is directed at getting beyond cause and effect thinking and into a systems view of the human phenomenon. Emotional reactiveness in a family or other group that lives or works together goes from one family member to another in a chain reaction fashion. Each person is programmed from birth to serve a certain set of functions, and each senses what is required or expected from the way the system functions. He or she does have one ability beyond all other protoplasmic life, and that is the ability to observe, think, abstract, and see the natural order, to understand the secrets of nature, and to govern him or herself a bit differently. In a nutshell, understanding our place in a relationship or in our relationship network will empower us to be able to make different choices in those relationships to people or things. The only real changes we have any control over are the changes in ourselves and our behaviors. One of the things that ministers use systems theory to try and understand is the only thing we actually have any control over is ourselves. We have no control over what you do, as much as you may want us to. Or you may want us to control somebody else, but not you. This is often the case. The only thing I have control over is what I do, and even then, that is a work in progress. And as Forrest Church offered in our earlier reading from his essay, How to Begin Changing Your Life, Thoughts for a Summer Day, he said, begin in the middle. Our lives will end mid-story, so why not begin there? Don't wait around for the perfect starting pistol or until you are ready. You may never be ready. No reason to wait in the grandstand for some official to guide you to beginning at the gate. Jump the fence. Enter the race in the middle. Here, now, as you are, by doing what you can with those who are closest to you, by turning the page, cleaning your slate, looking for new questions, not old answers, with little regard for where you are and where your path will lead. Finally, before you begin, a bonus suggestion. begins small. As we as a congregation move through those things that are involved with a ministerial transition, whatever that may look like over the next years, these are some of the questions we should keep in mind for ourselves individually and as a community, and a community within a larger community. Essentially, we honor what has been given to us by virtue of our simply being, by nurturing our divine seed, by making the most of what and who we are and who we can be. We use our providentially given self-searching and self-forming powers, as Channing says. In this, we accept the opportunities which come our way, even if initially they are another freaking growth opportunity. And with these, we can move through the pain and discomfort of change and growth together. Now, I also choose this path to nurture this holy potential because I am grateful for all that I am and have, the good and the bad and the ugly. There is also an old saying that what we are is a gift of God, and what we become is our gift of thanks. I seek fulfillment for myself and for others as an act of gratitude that all has given me life, and to all of those who have believed in me and who have nurtured me in this amazing, complex, interconnected garden of our existence. This is a direct rebuke to those voices in our society to say that we are self-made or that we are alone and we do not owe anything to others. This matter of choices also involves discipline. It is a recognition or experiencing that we cannot have it all and that something must be given up in favor of other things. This is what the word sacrifice means. It means to make a choice of making something sacred, of placing it above other things in our priorities. Sometimes sacrifices must be made on the altars of our better natures. Do I watch television or read? Do I vegetate or meditate? Do I take a walk? The purpose of discipline is not to hem us in, but to set us free into mindfulness and right living. In Buddhism, right living is not just a matter of right belief or of a faith, but of right action and attention. Right action and attention are a matter of being present as constantly and consistently as we can be, to be the here and now. To be mindful is to, without guilt, to remember when we remember. Changing our lives to be more of who we are and want and need to be is rarely easy or quick. However, it is an act of creation and co-creation with the universe and that which we call holy. It is a sacred act that may take a lifetime to unfold and to be realized. No one innately knows how to do this on their own. That is why we come together as a worshiping congregation, as study or meditation groups or covenant groups and choirs, as communities, to learn and share our journeys together. And like individuals, organizations like congregations have the ability to make intentional choices about who they are and who they want to be by making changes in line with their vision of who and what they want themselves to become. This is a part of the work that this congregation is doing in its transitional ministry, to reflect on and make choices about what you want to be and what changes are necessary to make those a reality. So as we engage with all the AFGOs of our lives, all the freaking growth opportunities, great and small, let us remember that the choices about what we do with them are mostly ours. that we often have to start in the middle of where we are and make small adjustments and not wait for the perfect moment to begin changing our lives. So be it. I invite you now to join us in our closing hymn, number 128, For All That Is Our Lives, and rise as you're willing and able in body or spirit.
All that is our life, we sing our thanks and praise, for all life is a gift which we are called to use to build the common good.
We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. May the Eternal bless you and protect you. May the Eternal smile upon you and favor you. May the Eternal befriend you and prosper you and all people, always in all places. Amen, and blessed be. Go in peace, return in joy. Amen. By the way, choir rehearsal is Thursday nights at 6 o'clock. Thank you.
go.